Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Honorable Deputy Chairman of Committees, we are taking up for debate today various institutions and commissions listed under His Excellency the President. I must at the very outset say that His Excellency the President, having got a very resounding mandate, have completed 1 year in office, and going by what he spoke when he addressed the nation 2 days ago, it appears that he is still under certain inhibitions about criticisms that have been leveled against him for his performance during the past 1 year. But of course, I believe that we must give him a little more time for him to bring all his programs to fruition. Having given that allowance, what we would expect from the presidency, since it is one election where the entire country votes as one electorate and selects the head of state, who is now vested with unbridled executive power, further strengthened by the 20th Amendment. Here, what I believe is that he had always said that he would be guided by expert advice, scientific advice on all matters. In that regard, he has set up a variety of committees. Now, before coming to those issues, let me first of all deal with the Human Rights Commission, which came into being with bipartisan support by this parliament almost 20 years ago. In its history, we have seen ups and downs about its performance. But one issue where the recommendations of the Human Rights Commission lacking teeth, lacking powers of implementation, has always been the primary issue of concern. Now, the Human Rights Commission has the power to visit detention centers, prisons, police stations, interview detainees, and submit recommendations. But then the institutions and office bearers who had to carry out those recommendations do not respond to those recommendations. From the IGP downwards, from the Commissioner of Prison downwards, this is a lacuna that has been observed. In the meantime, they also suffer with lack of funding, and then it is also advisable to give them sufficient funding so that they don't go begging for funds from outside sources. Therefore, that is an issue regarding which the government must pay more attention, make it more vibrant, and empower the Human Rights Commission to do its work, particularly this matter relating to school admissions. They give directions to directors of education, but then Director of Education, by as usual practice, has continuously been ignoring their recommendations. The only option available to the aggrieved party is to petition the Supreme Court. By the time the Human Rights Commission gives its finding, the time limit that is there to go before the Supreme Court has lapsed. So these are issues that have always been bothering the aggrieved parties, and therefore, in regard to Human Rights Commission, these issues have to be addressed. Now, coming to various other issues concerning the powers of the President, it is important for us to realize, I must say at the outset, some grievances about this COVID-19 program and its and addressing allowances for people who have been suffering with lockdown for a variety of days now. Now in Colombo, there are various areas. There is Valachene in Batiklo and several other areas where the Grama Sevakas are only giving the allowance for 100 families for a day. There are some Grama Sevaka divisions which has more than 2,000-3,000 families. So if you go at that rate, all these people who have lost their livelihoods, who are unable to go out, unable to engage in their usual vocations, are being deprived of their livelihood, and their survival is a big question. Therefore, at least the divisional secretariats must deploy more people. And some of the Grama Sevakas are now out of mortal fear of contracting the disease. Some of the Grama Sevakas have already contracted the disease. Because of that, they are not even doing their normal duties. I know they are functioning under severe stress and difficulties, but then they had to be supplemented with better staff and better support by the divisional secretariats so that these allowances could be distributed in time. Having said that, I must now come back to this issue of there are certain task forces that have been appointed under His Excellency the President. One task force, which was referred to by the previous speaker, relates to protection of archaeological and heritage sites in the Eastern Province. I simply can't understand that this has been a task force which is only focused on the Eastern Province. There are several other archaeological and heritage sites all over the country, but then it appears that 500 odd so-called sites which are of national importance and heritage and various other necessities, maybe that the government would have felt that there is some focus that needs to be given to that area. But in the meantime, there must be some mechanism that should be set up to engage with the civil society, to engage with the political authorities in that area, so that there would be a discussion on matters of contention. Because these are all very emotional, sentimental issues, where there are allegations without substantive evidence. Any allegation must be evidence-based. There, just because somebody is claiming these lands belong to. But in archaeology, when it comes to archaeology, putting up new buildings is not a given. The Archaeology Act very clearly says that it is to protect the artifacts and the monuments that are there. Putting up new buildings has become the, it's always observed in the breach. The legislation is observed in the breach when it comes to archaeological sites. And I would rather say that since there are these issues, the people of the area are always willing to cooperate.
Honourable Member, you have 2 more minutes.
Yes, provided there is substantial discussion on these matters with the civil society as well as the people who have got the mandate from the people of the area. I think there must be a proper mechanism set up so that these discussions, and that committee also lacks diversity. That committee should have representation by all communities. Just a committee consisting of one community cannot be expected to do justice by everybody. And this is seemingly a distortion in the formation of the committee itself. Now, coming to the composition of various commissions and independent institutions coming under the presidency, it is important not only to respect the diversity in the country and appoint people from different communities as mandated by the statutes. Even where the statute doesn't mandate, it is advisable that the diversity of the country be respected in making those appointments. I would say the issue relating to gender also must be taken into account. For instance, now we have increased the number in the election commission composition to 5, from 3 to 5, since there was an issue about quorum. I would prefer that the gender issue also be addressed, and that women are also considered to some of these important commissions where their contribution to this country, particularly when it comes to elective politics and representation in this country, women's representation has been an issue of contention for a long time. And therefore, it will be a good thing for the government to consider appointing a woman to the election commission as together with the rest of the commissions. We had Dr. Deepika Odagama leading the Human Rights Commission and did a wonderful job.
Honourable Member, the time is up. Please
resigned,
wind up.
We must see now that Human Rights Commission is without a chairman for several months ever since she resigned. Therefore, those issues have got to be resolved, and I hope the government will take these criticisms into account and redress those issues. And I would like to wish Dr. P.B. Jayasundara, who has who had a long career in the Treasury as the Secretary of the Treasury, has now become the Secretary of the President, to him and his staff and the rest of the chairman of commissions and other institutions coming and the president, I wish them the very best for the next financial year. Thank you.